Venki will take us through this lovely session with Javagal Srinath and Joy Bhattacharjya. So may I first invite Venki, Mr. Srinath. Please be seated for a few minutes. He'll invite you. So over to Venki. Okay.
Thank you, Harish, and very good morning to everyone. Pleasure to be here. This is going to be a very interesting session because we have two people in the panel who are people I know very well, and I also know that they are people who are not afraid to speak their mind at all, right? So you're going to get some very upfront and very interesting perspectives, I think, on a topic that possibly each of us in this room is very, very passionate about, which is sport. As a discipline, how does sport kind of move forward in India, and how do we kind of manage some of the challenges that we can have to scale them? I really don't need to introduce my panelists. A quick line of introduction: Javagal Srinath is the cricketer who set all Indian fist pumping by bowling really fast and really accurate and getting loads of wickets, and has been a fantastic ambassador for Indian cricket. As many of you might know, he's been involved in several other things with the sport since he retired from active playing in the sport. He's been a match referee for about a decade, but he's also been involved with some very interesting administrative elements in the sport. Joy Bhattacharjya is a dear friend. Joy is also Joy, in some sense, is the ideal person that a lot of us aspire to, because Joy has combined these two amazing things of quizzing and sport, and has put together a career which has been a lot of fun, and we'll hear him talk about it. But before I go any further, there's a very cool AV that the Imbue team has prepared to introduce our speakers. Can we have the AV on, please?
For Indian pace bowling, after Kapil Dev's swing had fired popular imagination. An Arjuna Award recipient, he was one of India's finest fast bowlers and remains the only Indian fast bowler to have taken more than 300 wickets in one-day internationals. He still remains one of the 11 bowlers who has taken more than 300 ODI wickets. Srinath holds an engineering degree but was attracted towards cricket right from an early age. After his retirement in 2003, he started off his second innings as reputed commentator and is also an ICC match referee. So far, he has officiated as ICC match referee in 24 test matches, 122 ODIs and 25 T20Is. He has left a legacy which Indian fast bowlers will follow for years to come. Joy Bhattacharjya is a veteran in the world of Indian sports and media, having been associated with the IPL since its inception in 2008. He is the former team director of Kolkata Knight Riders. An MCA degree holder, he quit his software engineer job to pursue his dreams and has never looked back since. Currently, he is project director of the first ever under 17 FIFA World Cup. He has helped produce live international cricket and has an active hand in creating superlative programs like ESPN School Quiz, Mastermind India, and Super Selector. Passionate about quizzing, he also writes quiz columns and conducts several shows as a quiz master. Recently, he authored the first 11 Junior Premier League.
Ladies and gentlemen, with a warm round of applause, please welcome our panelists, Javagal Srinath and Joy Bhattacharjya. So we're going to chat for about, I think, about 40 minutes, maybe. Please put in your questions on Pigeonhole. I can assure you, your questions will be answered with a great deal of candor and anecdotal perspective, right? So do that as the session goes on. But let me begin by bringing Sri into the discussion. So Sri, let me begin by asking you about that fabulous Yorker you bowled to Miandad in the Melbourne World Cup match. I'm just kidding. Sri has told me that we won't speak about specific matches, cricket, and go into one anecdotal rivalry over here. So we'll keep it to the issues at hand. On a more serious note, I want to begin with asking you at a very large level, in your experience, you've been an active player, then an administrator, you've been involved with sport. What do you think drives sport in India at a very larger level? with specifically with cricket, how have you seen, I mean, we've all seen change happen in cricket, in formats, in various other aspects of the game. How have you seen that unfurl in front of your eyes?
I think to start with, it was the patriotism. Going back to the 1947 days, I think, you know, you've seen Lagan, so obviously, I think it's, you know, the only sport. The only sport where we could compete at the international level or probably compete with the Britishers was probably cricket. And therefore, I think, you know, the game took deeper roots in India. I think everybody wanted to play cricket. That's because at best, you can play against the Britishers. And this is exactly, it's been endorsed by the Britishers a long time back. I used to play for Gloucestershire and then I had a chance to, you know, stay over in a bed and breakfast in one of the houses in Gloucestershire. And the gentleman who was around 80, 85 years old, he used to say that, you know, the passion for cricket, that's basically to compete at that level and then beat us. That gave them, you know, gave Indians some kind of a kick. And therefore, cricket took deeper roots then. But if you talk about now in the contemporary world, I think it is the retail world of India that has really changed the course of Indian cricket. Test cricket slowly evolved into ODIs. ODIs slowly evolved into T20s. This is nothing but, you know, the people are getting busy. Nobody has time to go and watch the test matches these days. But, you know, I mean, T20 came in nicely with the good package of entertainment. It's in the evening. At the same time, plenty of sponsors. I think the retailers, 10 CEOs, maybe 15 CEOs, some of you sitting here, you decide the course of the Indian cricket. And I think IPL has been a wonderful example of that. So, you know, it has a different context. So what people like and the cricket base in terms of interest has increased tremendously. And that's because largely towards you know, the retail base or the developing India, which has brought that cause.
Would you be personally happy with the direction the sport has taken in the country? This evolution from test cricket to this quick slam bang T20 cricket led by brands, marketing, money?
You can draw parallels to the way things have changed in India from 85 onwards. You know, India is a free market now. People are getting busier. So you don't expect people to go and watch a 5-day test match from morning to evening. Television has made it easy, but the connection is still strong. People do watch test cricket, there's no doubt about it. Then again, ODIs. I think some people still feel that it is still a, you know, one full day affair to get the final result. I think, you know, T20 elbowed its way into it. It's in the evening largely. You know, entertainment, cheerleaders, all those things add up. I mean, it has also increased, you know, the cricketers, I mean, not the purist, but also people who love to come and spend some time in the evening. So, you know, that's
it's
the way.
Expanded the base in some
exactly.
Sense.
That's the way the cricket, the game should evolve. You know, people, the purist will say that we don't like this game, but that's okay. They all have an opinion. But in the end, I think still it's the contest between the bat and the ball, and that has been really evolving over a period of time.
Would you have liked to play T20 cricket?
I would have loved to, man. My pockets are not full.
I think you would have been a slam bang batsman in T20 cricket.
I would have done anything to play this T20 game, but I think age was not on my side, so I missed the train, the gravy train, I would say. Yeah, but still good to be part of this game anyway.
Joy, I'll come to you on that note of the gravy train, right? You've been part of this gravy train from when it started with Kolkata Knight Riders, one of the most successful franchises in the country, most recognizable franchises, of course, led by a superstar who was here at MBU last year, by the way, as the keynote speaker, Shah Rukh Khan. How have you seen? So Joy has also been involved with sport in terms of being a sports packaging and presenting sports content for ESPN for a very long time. So he's seen sport from there, and then of course as part of KKR. So how have you seen the evolution?
My first point that I'd always like to make is that, you know, when people tell me that the purity of the game, I said if the game of cricket was really pure, women in hoop skirts would be bowling underarm on late pitches, because that's where cricket started. everything needs to evolve, okay? And for us to admit that it doesn't need to evolve is this thing. That doesn't mean that test cricket doesn't have its place, but the point of it is that this game is what is actually given cricket a chance to be a global sport. Because a three-hour format where you have a result is something that can travel around the world. You could not have done it. You know, when you told the Americans, okay, guys, two teams will play for 5 days, and then we may or may not have a result, they'd say, okay, fine, you know, let's go on to something more exciting. Today, you have a format that goes anywhere, and that's, I think, interesting and important, because for cricket to really flourish, the only real complaint that you'll ever have about cricket is the fact that it's not really a global sport, it's 11, 12 countries. This format, T20, can actually make it a global sport. And it's unfortunate that at this point in time, you know, the seismic changes in the BCCI and all, but this is the time for the ICC and everyone to take, because T20 cricket is something I have actually seen. The biggest point with it is the kind of audiences that you bought in once you got in a T20 sport, whether it's the cheerleaders, whether it's whatever it is, you have bought in women and children to watch the sport. Very important for overall viewership, also very important for sponsors. Suddenly you have a much larger area of people that you can deal with, and these are the kind of things that have made a difference. And the IPL has been at the forefront of that. It's been a set of fortuitous circumstances, but as I said, for Sri to work 300 days a year and then to hear about a cricketer earning 5 times that for 2 months a year. So if you look at it, yeah, 14, it's not easy, but 14 into 4, 56 overs is what they need to bowl for an IPL tournament. That's what a bowler needs to bowl for a tournament. That he would have probably done in 3 days when he was playing at his peak. That's the story of our lives. But IPL has been a game changer, and T20, I think, is a game changer. And for us to hold back and not recognize that may be unfair.
I think to add one more point to this, I think it's the TRPs of television which decide which sport will move forward. You know, cricket is ideally paced. Every over you get 2 minutes of break, so where you can probably introduce your products. And then again, you know, which TRP is the highest? I think everybody wants to go there. It's not the fault of the cricketers. At times I get questioned, you know, why cricket, why not other sport? I mean, hockey has been the most difficult sport. I tried it a couple of times. I mean, you bend, you're in an awkward position, and then you run the whole 1.5 hours, I mean, which is very, very tough in terms of skills and other things. But I think cricket is just a format which has fallen in place beautifully, which gives the retailers to do the best in terms of their branding. And therefore, cricket has come forward all this way.
I have one more addition to that, and that is that one is that, the other is, hockey, actually, you're right, is a not a great TV sport to watch. It's a terrific sport to watch, but the ball is very small, so the action can't be easy to catch, okay? And you don't know where the ball is going. Whereas in cricket, while the ball is small, you know that when the game starts, here's the pitch and where the ball is going to go. And to be honest with you, if you see the games around the world which have succeeded, they have to today be big television, good television spectacle. Table tennis, for example, they actually slowed down the ball. They said it's too fast a sport. So they actually made the ball larger so they could slow it down so that people could watch the action. Because they realized that without TV, you know, you're not going to make money. And whether it's TV today or whether you're streaming it on the net, it's the same thing. Is it a spectator sport on TV, or I mean, on the screen or not, is deciding a lot of things.
So this TV, digital, this large spectator sport thing is what is driving, you would say, all of the league formats in the country today, whether it's IPL, obviously, which was the pioneer of it. And I'll come back to asking you what you guys did at KKR, which went right and what went wrong. But IPL, ISL, Kabaddi, Badminton.
So I think there's a bit of a problem here, which, you know, I have had while at KKR and after that, at least 15 people. Other than the World Gilli Danda League, every other sport somebody has come and said, let's make a league with teams, film stars as the people on, you know, as their brand ambassadors, and do it. The truth is, it will not work. In fact, today I was reading Indian Polo League. Okay, everyone wants to do a league. Now, there are two parts to it. One is a part of saying, I will run a sport and a tournament professionally, which I'm all for. The second is a different point, which I don't completely agree with, which is that, here's the way. If I put it on TV, I make it slick. I have 2 cheerleaders and 1 film actor or actress who's my thing. I've got the sport.
It's very formulaic.
It's formulaic, and it doesn't work. It doesn't work. The other problem is sometimes money is a big issue. So the big issue, for example, is you do a badminton league. Okay, then you say that, okay, how much should Saina Nehwal be played? And you say, okay, she should be paid at least half that much of an IPL player. Okay, so here's the price I put for Saina Nehwal. Now I do the league. The truth is, it does not work that way. What it has to be is, how much can this league make and afford to pay Saina to remain a proposition which works?
So it has to be a classic business P&L that fulfills itself than basing on the IPL.
You cannot turn around and pay her five times what she deserves, because then next year the league won't happen. You cannot keep expecting people to invest just on the fact that one day it will get profitable. And that's the truth of it. Kabaddi worked because they did exactly that. They had players who were not known. They kept the base costs low, and that's why it worked. Therefore, every league that you see, just the one question you have to ask yourself is, is it modeled? Do they have the number of people? Are they going to deliver the numbers that they want to? Because otherwise, 2 years later, they'll all shut down again. And it's happened all the time.
One more point.
I think this is the mic.
I think you covered from the organizer's point of view, from the franchise owner's point of view, I think from the player's point of view, I think a lot of questions being asked about why this sport is more popular and why people choose. I mean, it is the kids at the younger age, they connect to this sport because they love the sport deep from their heart. That is the crucial element for somebody to succeed in this sport. I think some of the parents do force their kids into sport because they see something at the top. Okay, you play this sport, this is far better than you. But I mean, does it really align to their passion? Does it align to their to the talent what they have inside? So forcing kids to say that, okay, this is probably a better sport, you can probably make a profession out of it, doesn't work that way. I think you should just allow. I mean, whenever I this question is being asked, that, you know, it could be hockey or it could be something, you know, football, or maybe football is picking up now. It's the way the youngster, the way he starts looking at it, nobody can change the course of his sport after, say, 12 years. Okay, I will give up tennis because I see, the pasture is greener on the other side. So I will switch to cricket. Doesn't happen that way. So what you have in you, the way you have been conditioned throughout your younger days, how much you connect to the game, how much you think and grasp, assimilate, will make you a sportsman. So cricket cannot be like an academic situation where you try to be an accountant, now you change and you become an engineer, or you become a doctor, depending upon the marks what you get in the second PUC. It doesn't happen that way.
Yeah, I know. I've heard of this when we used to work with Anil in schools. We've heard of the stories of parents coming up and saying, okay, I'm going to put my kid into your coaching camp. Can you guarantee that he will get into IPL? Right? He'll get into an IPL squad. I mean, such guarantees are obviously difficult to come by. But I'm going to catch on to the point that Joy was just making about this whole organizing, administrating part of things. So one of the remarkable things that you did, Sri, after you, when you, Anil, Venkatesh Prasad, Roger Bini, a couple of you got together and decided to come in actively into sports administration, into the Karnataka State Cricket Association, it was a 3 year stint. Having done this, and having done this for what seems to have been a limited period, and now you are kind of temporarily out of it again, at least at the state administration level, where do you stand on this whole players transitioning to sports administration? Why would a player want to do that, and what works? And what worked for you guys? Why did you guys get into this? You and Anil could have done anything you wanted, but you chose to do this.
You know, people, you know, some people said, you know, why do you want to get into administration? You're just 42. What is so much about administration? Why do you want to get into it? You know, there is an ideological clash. You travel around the world. You see the infrastructure that is present everywhere. You see the structure, that is present. You see the transparency. You see the probity, you know, in their actions. And then you say, look, I think why can't our association be like that? And when you come closer to it, and when you are there almost, your association asks you to be part of their thinking, which means there is an ideal, you're changing your very ideology about the way you want to see the sport. And I think that was really burning, in our hearts. And then what we saw was not we liked. And I thought that was probably the right time to come in to understand, you know, can we make a difference to the sport? So therefore, we entered with a mission, we entered with a plan, we entered with few structure in mind, and we got into it. Now, why not many people get into administration, sportsmen get into administration? Not necessary that every sportsman is a good administrator. As a sportsman, I think you kind of, you have some reputation. I mean, that keeps growing over a period of time. You carefully guard your reputation on almost on every occasion. So by the end of your career, there is some reputation that you hold on to. When you get into administration, the first thing that people do in this democratic world is to attack your reputation. Right. Now, everybody's scared of that.
Worse with social media now.
Exactly. I mean, people will start calling you names. They will probably question your values, your moves. They say that, few things have gone wrong. You know, money has been mishandled. All those things. Now, for a greater cause, and that is not for you, for the kids of Karnataka state, if I'm worried about my reputation which I have built over a period of time, and then compromise on my values or my belief, and then stay away from it because my reputation will be tarnished, I don't think we are doing any good.
I think that's a remarkable point. I mean, I think that's a remarkable point.
Any public institution in this democratic world is challenging. First, we must stand up to it and then believe that we will make a difference. And number two, we will not look for acknowledgement. Number three, we will not listen to what people say. Four, let them play with my reputation. Am I confident with what I'm doing? Am I honest to myself? Am I making any difference to my cricket? I think we need to get into it. But if I stand guard to my reputation, I think I'm severely compromising on my values. Therefore, we got into administration. And further, after 3 years, we decided, look, this is not the way we can win an election. It has become very difficult in this democratic world to win a fair election for the second time. Now, can we compromise some more values for that? No, I'm not going to do that. But that's exactly what has happened now. I think people expect you to do few things which my conscience will not approve. Therefore, we decided not to get into it. But at least we have understood where we stand in the eyes of people. You know, when you become a cricketer, they think, you know, people see you in a different level. But when you get into administrator, as an administrator, I think that's the true world. That's the reality what we wanted to see at the same time. You will really know who your friends are, who your foes are.
Right.
The first thing is your foes become friends, your friends become foes. Are we ready to make that compromise?
Right.
I mean, you will be up for some disappointments. But I think no MBA, no IIM, or no Wharton, or no Stanford can give you this education. I think I had a quick degree to KSCA.
I think we are all grateful for that and for the fabulous work that you all did. I mean, I don't know how many people here know, but the amount of work that has been done in Karnataka outside Bangalore when Anil, Sri and Venki were at the helm of affairs is just remarkable. So there are several other centers of excellence that have cropped up all across Karnataka with the work they've done on infrastructure and several other elements of the game. And I think kudos to you for doing that and for having this remarkable clarity that, you know, you will not do this compromise. I think it's a debate that everyone in this room faces in a different way at work and in corporate life, but kudos to you for that. I'll move over to Joy now. Joy, you are now in the thick of what is going to be India's possibly biggest global event that we've ever hosted. So for those who don't know, India is hosting the FIFA Under 17 World Cup. This is a tournament that happens once in 2 years. This is the first time ever that India is hosting a FIFA tournament. And this is the first time ever, therefore, by virtue of being a host, India can field a team. And this is the first time ever an Indian team will play in any international FIFA football tournament at any level, right? So, you know, please share some of your remarkable experiences on putting this beast called the FIFA Under 17 World Cup together. And I'd like you to start with that anecdote you shared yesterday of the first meeting you had after the World Cup bid was given to India.
So yeah, it's been an amazing journey, and as I said, look, I can't say that life in the IPL was easy. After all, I was on the auction table when we decided not to take Saurav Ganguly, And when I switched on my phone, I had 350 messages, none of them complimentary. In fact, I told my father in Calcutta that maybe that the Brigadier SP Bhattacharjya, the notice board out there, maybe he could take it down for a couple of days. It might be better for his health. But World Cup has been a truly amazing journey because, you know, I came across this beast called the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports, Government of India, which is an entity in itself. And, you know, you've dealt with private companies, all dealing with government, and I'm sure a lot of you do. Of all the government departments, you see, government departments realize the value of a department is by the amount of money that they churn through, okay? So the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports is the lowest of the low, you know? So basically, the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports...
It's the punishment posting.
Yeah, their budget is basically the budget that the Defense Ministry spends in 3 hours a day. 3 hours of a day is the annual budget of the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. That's the truth of our lives. So the people who can tend to get there are not exactly the best bureaucrats in the country, let me put it this way. So our first meeting is there. There's this colleague of mine called Javier Chepi from Chile. And he's the tournament director, I'm the project director. We walk in, we meet this guy. And this guy is, firstly, you know, wearing chappals in a government office when you're a joint secretary is a bit... So we said, okay, fine, this is not the corporate world, let's not judge by appearances. So he sits there and says, haan ji, aapka toh World Cup ho raha hai na, haan, football World Cup na. India host hai. I said, haan sir, India host hai. Toh fir India ka toh do team banta hai. India A, India B, do team khilwaiyega. For a football World Cup, let's play two teams. I looked at Javier and, you know, he couldn't even believe it. He didn't, so fortunately it was in Hindi. I said, no, no, that was nothing. You didn't hear it. And that was our first exposure to what, you know, dealing with it is. The flip side of it is the power of government is something else. So, you know, what we are doing is we are taking this World Cup and saying, World Cup is going to be played over 6 to 28th of October next year is going to get over. But if we don't use this to be an inflection point in Indian football, it's not worth it. So we've started something which is basically the idea is to take this football everywhere around the country with the government, with FIFA. It's called Mission 11 Million. And while FIFA, the World Cup will be played at only 6 venues, this is something we are going that will go across to 30 states where the idea is to get 11 million kids to kick balls. Because the only way you can teach kids about football is to get them to
It's going
to
be India's largest school contact program ever.
Yeah, it is.
And how many schools are you looking at?
We are looking at 15,620 schools. And it should be larger. The truth of it is how we've, what we believe in. And there's two very simple things. One is, it sounds extremely reasonable, but people can't get onto it. Playing 11-a-side football, large-size football for any kid below the age of 15, 16, is a complete waste of time. Because it's too large a ground. That sort of ground is meant for people who can run, you know, a professional athlete who can run 11, 12 kilometers. What you need, and everywhere in the world now, they're playing 4-on-4, 5-on-5, more touches. Boys play, girls play, they all play together. And that big field now, which is, you know, 22 people are playing, you can have 12 pitches out there where potentially 120 kids are playing. So one is getting them to do that. B is now, if you have a small pitch, you have something this size of a stage, we say you can play football. FIFA says you can play football. And that's
And real estate is also very expensive.
Exactly. Yeah. So places like Bombay, we say, man, you have a large enough classroom, you can play football. Send us your pictures, FIFA may put it up on our website. So that's one. Second is our belief that the real gatekeepers, kids always want to play. The real gatekeepers in our country are the parents and principals of schools. See, the PE teacher is again the lowest of the low, you know. He's nowhere. The principal of school, English teacher, maths teacher, physics, science, PE teacher is there.
Absolutely.
So what we do is, we have a seminar, call in the principals and the PE teachers, give the PE teachers, very short seminar, 1 hour, give the PE teachers material to do the stuff in their schools, but the principal, we give them plaques, we make them happy, we tell them all the stuff that they could win, or be recognized for, because if the principal is not behind it, there's no. When we give the kids prizes for whatever they do, 50% of the prizes are targeted to the parents. Because when you take a kid and say, wow, you know what, you've played well, here's a prize, it's a holiday for four to Goa for 3 days, when the kid takes that prize back, it's not a jersey, his mother says, wow, you mean playing football, you can win a prize like that? That is what's going to change perceptions. Because the problem in India for sport is the gatekeepers. So what we are trying to do really is just change the way people look at football, because that's what's going to make the difference for us.
And like Sri was saying earlier, I mean, you need the, in all sport, you need the parents to come out and support the kids while they are playing, right?
Exactly. I think what Joy said, I think he hit the nail. Even in cricket, I think I'm sure many of your children, grandchildren will be playing sport.
Grandchildren, cricket, Sri, it's not that old an audience, Sri.
Sorry. They will become grandparents one day. We send kids to coaching camps and stuff, and you know, they are at the age of 12, he's carrying 156 gram ball, which is, you know, his wrist cannot even hold that ball. He's wearing a pad which is all the way up here, and he's bowling from 22 yards where he has no strength. The moment you see that, you should say, I'm not paying any money here, bring it to the level of the kids. You know, these are the transformation that needs to be made at the grassroots level.
Absolutely.
Okay, and when you see that, I mean, your kids are wasting time there, they will lose interest. You know, if the kid loses his interest in cricket at the age of 13, 14, in fact, talent really comes out in you at a certain age. You know, your body is growing, your mind is growing, you know, it's all physical, you see. I mean, physiologically, you're getting stronger. So if you lose that interest at the age of 14 and 15, probably your cricket would have been at its best at the age of 21, 22. So the right kind of equipment, the right kind of infrastructure has to be provided for the kids. This is exactly what we try to do with KSCA. I'm not coming back for the elections again. Don't worry about that. I'm not putting.
I wish we could vote. We would happily vote for you, but unfortunately we can't.
Yeah. So you know, people should realize that when the parents watch, because I believe that 80% of the kids' progress is because of the parents. 20% is from the coaches or from the institution where he goes to play. 80% is what you parents decide on the course for the kids. Now, if you see these kind of attributes in any sporting infrastructure, you should say, thank you, I don't want to be here. So what I say is that allow your kid to gain the talent or to optimize that talent, or wait for the kid to, where the talent can really match his, you know, physiologically, psychologically. So it could be 19, it could be 18. A kid who is extremely good at the age of 14, not necessarily that he will be good at the age of 19. And somebody who looks very ordinary at the age of 14 will be superb talent by the age of 20. So, you know, that's something which I think all of us need to factor in. I think Joy brought it out. I thought it will also be applicable for cricket too.
No, absolutely.
No, I think that's two very solid takeaways. One is that if you want your kids to succeed in sport, you have to make the effort to go out there and be with them when they play. You will just have to make the time for that and take the interest in that. And the other important thing is not to over-configure some of these things, right? So to do it the right way, at the right level, and not think that bigger is better necessarily, you know, if I might put it in a way.
No, absolutely. In fact, when we look at these, exactly this case, you know, we went and we did this seminar in Goa. And there was this presentation convent from Goa, these nuns in their habits, principal of a school suddenly out there. And she was sitting and she said, my girls can play. And they went back there and they had this sort of cement badminton court and they put their four cones and she kicked off, wearing that nun's habit, she kicked off a football. And if I do anything else, that picture will stay with me for my life, because suddenly there are 600 girls in that school who can enjoy a game. And I've seen the pictures of them playing it after. It'll warm the cockles of your heart. So we've got to get that to the game. The other thing I will tell you, very simple thing. We talk about infrastructure. So the moment we say, do we do well in football, infrastructure is an issue. Okay, wait a minute, just hold on. 11 World Cups have been won by European countries, terrific infrastructure. 9 have been won by South American countries, shambolic. They have state-run stadiums as bad as ours. Their facilities are rubbish. Their kids play on the streets. People like Pele, Ronaldinho learned football. Alexis Sanchez came from the slums. They learned football with rags, playing on streets. If you see the film Pele, you'll see that. And I'm saying, so it's not infrastructure. What is it? It's passion. What's the basic problem? Today, if you have a school team, you're not interested in football, your kid is going to play. There is one parent who's got the money and got the interest. He goes and tells a PE teacher, who's again the lowest of the low, mera beta ko khila do. Are any of you there to protest? You're not. None of you even know. So the point is, the good kid who's playing at that level is saying, man, I don't get a chance, ye to PE teacher to in charo ko leta hai, because their parents have put the pressure. Now, the other problem is, unlike cricket, somehow, one of the reasons it circumvents it is because at the end of a cricket match, you have some numbers you can look at. This runs scored, wickets taken. At the end of a football match, you could have a 1-1 or a 0-0 match. There is not a number you can put to a player. So any kid can be picked up. So one of the biggest problems is at the school level, the kid is saying, man, what's the point of playing? Coach never picks me and walks away. And if parents don't get involved at that level, you're never going to get the players. So it has to be about the gatekeepers. It has to be about you showing the passion to go there. Otherwise, you're just losing the players at that stage. After that, he's not interested.
Yeah, but I think it's not that I'm disagreeing with what you're saying, but I think it's passion, of course. That's the base of any sport or any profession for that matter. If that passion meets the right infrastructure and if you have the talent, I think that's where we can be consistent.
Yeah, that's a sweet spot, yeah.
Exactly. I mean, these all three has to align one after the other nicely. But yeah, when we take examples up in all this, I mean, we produced Chandrasekhar's, we produced Prasanna, we produced G.R. Vishwanath, who played on matting wickets. But I would just say that, I mean, they would have extended their careers for another 5 years if they were given the right kind of infrastructure.
No, no, absolutely. I mean, in fact, I believe that we should, one of the things of the World Cup is, while the main stadium is important, every venue has 4 training sites which are made with just as good fields and facilities. And those are the ones which are really going to get used, because, you know, stadiums will not get used. My point is that while we are waiting for infrastructure to catch up, and in India it's actually not making infrastructure, it's maintaining it. We don't maintain it. We make it all very good, we do the inauguration, and then we let it crumble. We can't allow that to be an excuse. We just got to keep building infrastructure, but keep saying that, boss, don't use that as an excuse against us.
Now, with the parents, what I was talking about, I think picked it from you just now, is that, you know, we ran an academy for KSC, and then, you know, we gave a test for the parents, and the kids were all under 16, from under 12 to under 16. We gave them a very convoluted question so that, you know, they will not be able to really understand the intent behind that question. One Mr. Sheshadri from NIMHANS, he was the man behind it, a child psychologist, and he did this, gave this questionnaire to all the parents. You know, to my shocking, out of, say, 40 people whom we gave the questions, almost 23 of them wanted their sons to become Sachin Tendulkar, Virendra Sehwag. My name never figured in one of those numbers, doesn't matter. They wanted to be Rahul Dravids and everything. I think only 7 or 8 of them said that, I just want my son to play this team sport. I want my son to win and lose and have life skills through sports. Fabulous. That was fantastic, you know, what we got to get from the parents. It is about sharing how my son will cope up when he has lost, what kind of inputs he gets when he loses. When he wins, can he hold on to himself? You know, 3 or 4 of them mentioned it, and we highlighted it throughout. Of course, that's exactly the answer what we wanted from them. But sadly, 23 of them, which is more than 60%, I would suppose, said that, I want him to be A, B, C, D. But I think that will happen if this is perfect.
I think we're completely out of time. I've been told to start asking you the audience questions. There's an app through which people have put in the questions for the audience. But before I go there, I want to hog 5 more minutes at max and ask you one last question before we go to the audience questions. We are here in an audience at a forum, imbue with some of the best management minds in the world, certainly in the country. How do people like this come into or contribute to or get involved with Indian sport?
You must give it a try. Look, in India, sport is still not a profession. It is still amateurish. I think if you go by the numbers, I don't think we can provide profession to the players. How many people, I mean, millions play cricket. I think including IPL, Ranji Trophy, as well as Test cricket, you're only employing 500 people, not more than that, maybe 600. But the aspiration is plenty. So, you know, you have a decent structure, but will that really take you all the way? I mean, what is a profession? By the end of it, this sport, cricket or football or hockey, should take you for the next 15 years, from 20 to 35, and it should also give you directions to take care of your life for the other 25 years. You know, when I was retiring, I went to Narayan Murthy's house one day and then said, sir, my career is getting over now. I don't know. So he said, have you thought about yourself? He said, we all retire at the age of 60. You're retiring now. What do you do for the next 26 years? I mean, that was a big question which started worrying me. What I want to say is that still it is amateurish. I don't think we still have a great structure. Authoritarianism will come in every now and then. It's not a proper structured one because, you know, it involves elections at every stage. Wherever you have elections, you will have problems. That's for sure. Which means you leave it to the whims and fancies of the people to elect you, there is trouble. I think talent will suffer. But still, I think you can give it a try. But that is, I mean, you need to get in with a charity intent than a professional intent. So there is a skewed way of understanding. So some people can do it. Some people can get into it. But I think it will take some more time for the market to mature. A lot of things need to be corporatized. That's very important. I think we need to see this as a corporate, otherwise it becomes difficult. IPL has brought some confidence in trying to take this professionally. But if you really look into the mass, I don't know whether there is a quick solution for this. A lot of people have done their degrees in sports career and they come, they stand, you know, blank. They don't know where to go, what to do. And they regret a little later. So, you know, still a long way to go, I suppose. Many can apply.
Joy, what do you think? Do you think the AIFF will ever have an IIM Bangalore alumnus as its CEO?
Possible. To be honest with you, the current AIFF Secretary General is a chartered accountant from St. Stephen's College who was the CFO of the ICC, and which is actually, we run our accounts on SAP. It's the most transparent sporting body in India by a long mile. So it's not impossible. Yes, definitely. I think what Sri has said is at its basic core. Look, if you have to look at two things, I'd say. One is that if you look at India and sport in India. Sport in India was like media was in 94, 95. Advertising was just beginning to take off. Okay. So pluses, minuses is it's a disorganized sector, extremely disorganized sector. Pluses are it's a huge upside possible. So it's a nascent place where lots is happening. Things are not settled. Today, if you go into the advertising industry, it's very settled. The media industry is very settled. This is just where things are beginning to break. So there's opportunities. Secondly, the way I look at it is very differently for a lot of you people. Many of you guys out here have gone there, been there, done that in the corporate world. You've done it. Okay. Here's an opportunity. Maybe sports is an opportunity to come back and say, you know what? I have made some great investments in money, in time. I've made good money. Maybe I can make some amount of investment in my nation's future, and I can start doing something in sport which may not pay me as much as it is used to, but maybe it's time to start, you know, it's an opportunity to pay
but
back.
But Joy, shouldn't it start from the player's point of view? Because I think at the age of 16, a boy should say that I will take cricket as a profession for the next 10 years. If that happens, I think automatically at the top level, I think professionally will fall in place. I'll give you an example. I mean, when I used to play for Gloucestershire, there was this guy called Matthew Windows. He was 15. His father came. He quit studies. And he joined cricket for the next 6 years. He played for England A. And I was following his cricket. And that is professionalism. He's been paid at the age of 16. And he was okay. And once he could not make it to the highest level at the age of 21, he went back to the 11th standard. Now, can I do that? With my beard, can I go and sit in the 11th standard? It's not possible. I think psychologically, our system doesn't allow such things to happen. So it should be a hobby. If it turns out to be a profession, well and good.
Yeah, my point is for administrators. So there's so much, say, for example, at the school level, at block level. And you're right. The biggest problem is the moment the federation comes into it, elections come into it, that's where it gets really this thing. But there's some really good things happening with smaller clubs, smaller institutions, organizing tournaments, neighborhood things, just starting small. Because see, one of the big things is sports is just, if you look at sports as an industry may not look very big to you immediately. But if you say sports plus fitness, now you're changing the entire look and shape of it. Because today, at least 95% of this people in this room will say, I have a commitment towards staying fit, which is either by running or exercise or some sort of sport. So if you look at sport as fitness as an industry in the whole, you immediately do what Cadbury did, you know, from changing from chocolates to sweets and saying that, okay, I have the larger picture. So anyway, I think opportunities are where, you know, it's a market which is nascent, open, it's exciting.
Plus
as well.
There are the intersections of all the new age things like technology, data analytics, you know, all of those things. Yeah, absolutely. I think there is undoubtedly a path forward where I think corporate India can get involved with sport, not just with branding, but with in several other ways, right? So let's go to the questions that are on Pigeonhole. First question is obviously to Sri, and it's a question that all of us have asked over a very long period of time. Why has India not been able to create genuine fast bowlers like Shoaib Akhtar, Brett Lee, bowling consistently over 150 kilometers per hour? After you, that is.
Well, I mean, T20 is all about sixers and fours. Where is the scope for the bowlers to come back into the game? So when people ask me, you know, how does a bowler come back into the game, is by batting.
So bowlers are also working on their batting skills.
So I think, you know, it has been a tough. I think I can take the case of Ishan Sharma. You see, he's somebody who based his cricket on test cricket. And you have some kind of satisfaction in your performance when you do that. You know, you believe that, okay, I have done reasonably well. But then that ODIs, the wicket got flatter and flatter. And the T20s, it is about how to bowl a dot ball, which means you have taken the sting completely out of the bowlers. And what you have done is, can you save this ball? You know, can you give four runs? I'm happy with that. But can you just don't get hit for a six? Is this what your captain is asking for? And the boundaries are shorter. The bats are thicker. Balls really fly, you know, all over the place. I think the batsmen have gone up, you know, I mean, the format itself. 20 overs, 10 batsmen. If not me, somebody else will come and tonk over anyone. So, you know, this has really made it one-sided at the moment. So, therefore, you will not see many winners or you will not see many champion bowlers. And therefore, you know, it is tough for the youngsters to emulate. So, I'm watching the match and then as a kid, okay, there is no wicket falling, nothing, only sixes. Let me hold the bat and hit another sixer. So, you want to be part of the winners most of the time.
I'd just like to add to that. You had the list, you know, why haven't you produced bowlers like Shoaib Akhtar and all? I've dealt with Shoaib Akhtar for 1 year in the IPL. Maybe it's not such a bad thing.
Maybe it's not such a bad thing after all.
I
all
promise right. you that, you know, if I ever wrote my autobiography, in that short 1 year, three chapters would should only be about Shoaib Akhtar.
Okay. We are waiting for that. I mean, those who follow Joy on Facebook will know that he's a wonderful raconteur and keeps narrating fantastic stories about Calcutta and about sport. Joy, I think this question is something that you can take a shot at. I myself running a sports startup get questions from wannabe entrepreneurs, people who want to enter the space saying, what are the prospects for startups in the field of sports? Where are the opportunities really today?
Thanks. I think Manoj has a very relevant question. My answer to that would be, again, the largest area, you know, there are going to be one or two really big ones. We don't know where they're coming and how they're going. But there's a lot of, as I said, small things to be done. Leagues to be put together, little packages to be done. Smaller format stuff, there's a lot going on and where there's opportunity. For example, just matching, and I think this has been successfully done in quite a few places, matching desire to play with other people who play the same sport and putting them together for an opportunity
right.
to play.
So some sort of a marketplace.
Simple aggregators like that, for example, have a huge value. The second thing is that, very interestingly, you know, we have a whole sort of quali thing about sport. So far, and you know, you can't make it, you can't do an ICSC for a say for a cricket batsman, but there are certain basic parameters, even for a footballer, for example, that you do, which you can now start doing testing at that kind of level. And there are opportunities there. So I would say, and the third, obviously, there's data analytics, which is going to become bigger and bigger. And I think, as I said, there are lots of opportunities around sport as well, not just in sport, but around sport as well. And you just have to find
those
them.
Are probably the spots to go into.
Yeah, the lower hanging fruit, in my
right.
opinion.
Right. Can we have the next question up? The next highest voted question? Yeah. Sri, this is probably for you. When a sports person gets injured, will leadership... Okay. What happened?
You don't want me to ask that question?
No.
Okay. When a sports person gets injured, will leadership really take a beating? How does one really come back from a very bad injury when you've gone under, say, the surgeon's knife? And I think the second question is unrelated. It's related in a way, the sense of saying that what you just alluded to. How do bowlers take inspiration and become winners?
I went through a career-threatening shoulder operation. A lot of things crossed my mind during that period. It was in 96. Now, good things do happen when you're injured too. Now, I started my engineering in 87, and I have done the longest engineering till 97. I know a lot about technology. I have studied the same subjects again and again. I am thorough. So when I had my shoulder injury in 96, that was the time I finished my degree. I had three more subjects to finish. So I was, you know, we all coming from a middle class family, you know, you go to school every day, whether you like it or not. I mean, you go to school every day and then you get to the pre-university, you get to the next level and to the next level, and then you get into engineering, and then three subjects were stopping me. Now, you know, I had to finish it. You know, it gives you such a, you know, confidence for you to walk up in this society. And we are a service-minded people. Our community, I mean, our economy is more service-minded. The first thing is, I think, you know, Joy, one of the public sector's best thing about public sector is you have a degree, we have a job. I think that was stuck in my mind. And no matter what I do for my mother, the first thing is that, you know, you should have a degree. So even if you get 500 wickets, do you have a degree? So that question was,
yes.
That was haunting. I mean, watch, I mean, the first question, what we ask a kid, what are you studying? And the second question is, when he is little, 21, 22, maybe 23, where are you working? What's your degree? So this is a typical Indian way of doing things. Anyway, so that gave me a chance to finish my degree, and I wanted to do my degree because what in case if my shoulder doesn't come up again for the board to the level of bowling, then I need to get into normal stream profession and get going. So it is dampening. We didn't really have a good support system then. Yeah. But of course, you know, I must thank Dalmia, who really stood up and said, go to whichever part of the world, get yourself operated, and we'll take care of that. So there was no profession which was guaranteed after, but I think I was taken care of. I mean, that's the beginning of Indian sports medicine into India. A lot of good things happened to India after that. It is the risk that you take. It's like, I would say, a very bad example. If somebody meets with an accident, what do? You can't do much. Your organization will take care of you to a large extent, but beyond that, you've got to face it. That's your fate. We have to be careful. Sports medicine has really improved now. You got to understand your, you know, the physics of your body and make sure that, you know, you're fit. And that is one risk you always run. But I think now, I think sports medicine is so good that whatever that you do, except replacing your brains to think better, everything can be replaced, honestly.
Right. I just want to add a story that I was once comparing a show where Maninder Singh, who is one of the funniest men I know, was with Wasim Akram. And Wasim Akram is, you can't keep him quiet, plus he has had a colorful career on and off the field.
Right.
So, Maninder Singh turned to Wasim Akram in a very straight face and says, you know, Wasim bhai, I have only one question to ask. So he says, Mani bhai, bataiye. He said, sir, you played 18 years as a fast bowler and the only injuries that you ever had were groin injuries. Why? And that was the one time that I saw Wasim Akram quiet for about 30 seconds. Amazing.
Now, I want to take the second part of the previous question to you, Joy. How did, as IPL team management, how did you motivate your bowling units? How did you keep them together? Because like Sri just explained, I mean, the bowlers get whacked all the time in T20. Their role is very defensive. Their role is very containing. How did you guys keep your bowling unit together? How did you keep them motivated?
I think there are two parts to it. One is that Sri would tell you, all these teams, once they start off, you will have a bowling captain in your team. So they'll have their own meetings. And what happens is, therefore, you're not working against the target of saying, I'm going to do this on that. You may say, for example, when we used to play against Bangalore, the rule used to be that, with this thing, bowling to Virat Kohli, no ball should be closer than 18 inches from the off stump. Because in those days, he used to hit it all day. Of course, now he's got so good, you put it there, he'll hit it for six over cover. But like that, they used to make targets and within small things, motivate themselves. Because that's the only way you can do it, you know. Take small things, take small targets, say, I'm not going to give a four in the last ball. You know, those used to be little, little things, and they keep themselves going that way. Because, yeah, if you look at in real and absolute terms, you know, there's a huge disparity between batting and bowling, as he'll tell you.
I think give 65 options. So by the time the 65 options are all over, the season is over.
The season is over, yes.
So you retain your place.
Right, right. Sri, this question is for you. Who's your favorite captain you've played under, and what made him your favorite leader or captain?
You know, you see captain in a different way when you just get into the side. I think Azhar was the captain. I mean, I was just, 21, 23-year-old boy when I came into the side. So your connection to the game, your connection to the players, your connection to the captain is different. You're more submissive. You're not speaking about it. You're not vocal about your thoughts. You cannot put your plans across, although you have a plan. Now, whether the plan is good or bad is a different thing. So the way I saw captain was different. That happens to everyone, I suppose within, even in your normal, any industry, probably the same things happen. But I think you gain your voice over a period of time with what you do. And then again, you see things better, your acceptability factor has increased. And then, of course, Azhar was very submissive. You do your job, whether you do right or wrong, you know, selectors will assess you. Being a nice person not necessarily means that you're a good captain.
Good captain.
So that's Azhar, and then we went to Sachin. Sachin was you know, somebody who could pluck anything from thin air. You bowl an outswinger, he's ready to bowl an outswinger. You want an in-swinger to come in, the in-swinger would come in. You want to bowl a leg spin, he would bowl a leg spin, off spin, anything. And then he used to say, when I can do it, why can't you do it? Now that logic failed me completely.
That just didn't work.
Yeah. He was demanding, no doubt, in a nice way. He was demanding, very demanding. And it made me struggle under him, in a nice way. That, of course, up my ante. I wanted to do better. I wanted to prove him. And he used to stand at slips and say, Abhi andar dalna ball. Arey yaar. Abhi bahar kar do. Outswinger, I never bowled outswinger in my life.
Right.
Abhi bahar dal do. Why can't you do it? Look, I'm bowling out now. You know, why can't you do this? You know, it was tough. But you know, in all these things, it is, you know, we could not communicate. We kind of, when I took a wicket, I didn't even shake his hand sometimes. I was just, you know, he came, patted my back, and then, you know, words, there are very few words exchanged. You know, these are phases that we go through. What really touched me was, this was a Sri Lanka test match in 96, in my comeback after my injury. And we still had the same kind of equation. And just before the practice, I was on the toss. Just before the toss, I had a sprain in my back, and I limped back to my dressing room. And the physiotherapist was Andrew Lepis, the new guy, was working on me. So before going to the toss, Sachin didn't speak to me at all. Before going to the toss, he came to me and said, "Are you fit?" I said, "I don't know." "But Sri, bolna, are you fit or not?" I said, if you bat first, I'm fit. If you field, I might struggle. And he went away, and I was saying that, you know, he's so cruel. I mean, he's just demanding whether I'm fit or not, and he doesn't see me that I'm struggling with, I mean, I'm on the table struggling. He doesn't even see that. I mean, I was also livid to some extent. And then again, he came back. Then he said, Sri, tu fute? I bola, bhai, same thing again. Even if you're 50% fit, you play this match. Now that immediately changed my perception towards Sachin completely. You know, that's honesty again from Sachin. You know, that's the human touch, what he brought. That's what you want from a captain. And all the things that I had, he's tough, he's extremely difficult to handle, all of things changed within 2 minutes. I was ready to give my life to him on that day. Then that's what you want from a captain. So a captain need not be bad all the time. Now, bad is about setting the expectations right between the two. And we had this issue every now and then, and then we are very honest. We were very honest with each other. And I was not the one who would sit and say, okay, you do this, I will do that. No, I'm not going to do that. what I know is that is what I'm going to do. So it was a very healthy relationship what we had. We had a lot of disagreement, but when he came back as a captain in 1999, I think for the second time, he was a far better captain. He was much calmer. He spoke nicely. He was able to, you know, understand the limitations of people. All those things happened because he was probably 6 to 7 years younger to me then. And then came Ganguly. By then, I think 5, 6 of them in the team were captains anyway.
Right.
Right. So making. You had
musical chairs.
You had Gangu, you had Sachin, you had Rahul. Rahul was much younger, but you had most of the players were
right.
Quite well versed, and I think it was probably the easiest thing for Ganguly to do. So yeah, we all say Ganguly was the big captain, great captain, all those things understood. But what made him the best captain is the 5, 6 people who took decisions for him down the line, which Ganguly will never admit.
Right. Are you going to tell us a nice Ganguly anecdote?
First, I'll tell you another Wasim Akram anecdote, which he's one of those guys. So apparently, Wasim was there, and if India has this problem, Pakistan has it even worse. So apparently, Akib Javed was bowling, you know, and those were the days, you know, all these players change in 90s. They changed captains, like we change, you know, buses when we go to office, you know. So Wasim, apparently Akib Javed finished the over and said, "Here, skipper," and turned to toss the ball. And 8 people turn to look at him.
Right.
No, but one thing about Ganguly, I must say, that is that, you know, you could speak your mind to him. I don't think many captains is ready to accept it. But you can express your emotions, hot and cold. You to sit and listen. He had no other option. That's another thing. But, you know, that was one of the good qualities of Ganguly. But only thing is, TV ka samne mat bolna. So he didn't want the camera to catch it, but otherwise, I think, you know, every captain has his good sides and bad sides. So, you know, I thoroughly enjoyed all three of them.
Did Saurav have the same styles when he was managing a multicultural team like a KKR?
I think, look, two things. One is that we didn't do well under him. That always impacts
rankles,
what it is.
Yeah.
I think Saurav is best as a captain when he's confident as a player. When his own game is off, then his, for us at least, he was thinking more about struggling with a format which,
right.
If you remember, a lot of those cricketers, that generation, even a Sachin or a Rahul, had to adapt to T20. It didn't come naturally to them because they played the peak of their careers in a different format.
Right.
So Saurav struggled with T20 as a concept and this thing. And it's not an easy concept because, say, one of the things is you can't afford to spend too many balls to get in. So the issue is, if you don't get in, you get out. The big crime is not getting out in T20 cricket quickly. It's that if you've seen 10 balls and got out, then you've really cost the team because, you know, you had a chance to get set. So because he struggled with a lot of that, maybe he, as a captain, could not get all that he did. And look, at the end of the day, results always, no matter what happens,
right.
Results that call it. I mean,
right.
Sachin, as he said, was a much better captain in 99. But Sachin, when we went to Australia, we just didn't have the team to perform under him, you know. And that also matters. So I think all these are factors. And as he said, all these are great captains in their own way. But each are fascinating in their own regard.
One last question before we wrap up the session. And both of you can quickly take a shot at this and we'll wrap. Historically, sports ministers are known for their lack of knowledge of sports. When do you think India will see an accomplished sports person in charge of not just an association, but of the sports ministry itself and make a real difference? Any ambitions, Sri?
Look, you cannot just generalize that. Mr. Ravichandran, I had an experience with Uma Bharati, the sports minister then. I'm talking about 1999. So we had dinner at the Prime Minister of Atal Bihari Vajpayee's house. So we got a chance. We were in the midst of all this match fixing and stuff. And that lady was so sharp because you go with a different expectations with the attire and looks and so on and so forth. But for every question you ask, she used to answer the next 5 questions what you have in your mind. I think that's the brain what she had, honestly.
She's prepared.
I think, you know, we were all taken aback. It's not that. I think generally the way they see things, I mean, we cannot just see the bad side of people, or probably though our own perception might be different. But I think by the end of it, I think I had to change my thinking towards my people. I mean, we cannot just go with a unidimensional thinking that, you know, they wouldn't know anything or they wouldn't know much. I think mass leaders, they have something more than what we think. And I think when you get to know them personally on one-on-one basis, you will realize. I think few of us, when she spoke to us, you know, on the sidelines of the dinner, we were shocked about the knowledge what she had. It was nothing but a general approach towards life, what she spoke. Right. I think she answered 5-6 questions well ahead of what we could even ask.
Right. So it's not really fair to make such a sweeping statement.
There could be somebody who could not even know anything about sport, but
sure.
I will be very wary to make such statements here.
Right. Joy?
Two things. One is that, firstly, give, as we said, even sports ministry is a punishment posting. So we have the average government lasts for about 4.5 years in the last 20 years. But we've had about 10 separate sports ministers. So one of them is continuity. Somebody needs to sit there. You know, it takes you 6 months to start understanding a ministry. So one is that if you had sports ministers who stayed for 4-5 years for a full term, there's a much better opportunity to get something done because they know what the animal they're dealing with. The second is that, look, it is systemic. It's not about a sports ministry. Right now, there's a sports code. There's a sports bill. If you need to change those things, basically how sport is run and administered in the country, that is what you need the difference in. See, a minister at the end of the day, don't forget, sport is a state subject. So the large budgets are lying with the various states. It's not lying in the central government. It's not a central subject. But what you can do in centrally is create a situation where you're saying that, okay, if you don't come, if you're not an associate that adheres to A, B, C, D, E, you will not get funding, you will not get chance to forget funding, you know, because a lot of these guys can work out funding because, you know, it works in other ways. But at least you can say that if you don't do this, you will not be allowed to put India on your jersey. And that can make a difference. I think that's what we need. We need continuity and we need a very, very strong, you know, the reason why our democracy is where it is today is because Mr. Ambedkar and visionaries like him thought a way 70 years back of how we can do it. And therefore, whatever it is, our institutions of, you know, democracy have remained strong. We need somebody to write a sports bill like that. Somebody that remains strong no matter what the kind of pressures it's under. That's really needed.
And I think it's hopefully getting in that direction, and with things like the FIFA Under-17 World Cup happening, I think the entire country will come together to make it a success, and I'm sure all of you in this room will contribute in your own way. On that note, ladies and gentlemen, let's give a warm round of applause to our panelists.
Thank you. Thank you, Joy. Thank you, Srinath.